We cannot save our tank systems if the local governments are not functional. And the local governments should be functional in such a way that the local communities control the local governments. Right now, local governments are ritually set up by the state cabinet or the major party in power. So that new revolution that we want, if we want to save our tank systems and small rivers, rivulets and all that, it has to be through local governments. And one such effort was this. We actually tried doing that. After we had the 73rd and 74th Amendment, we really worked with the local councils, and there was one network which was working in the Panchayat Raj systems. I was more involved with the urban areas, working with municipal councils, small panchayats, Nagar panchayats, and so on, to try and protect their own water systems, right? What we found was that though there was a very high level of interest, because of the power of the political party over the local government or the local leaders, things didn't move far. So, in a sense, the petition was filed to force the same agencies to go in that direction, because people are now suffering because of lack of fundamental requirements. So they are not going to wait. The next thing that you expect is a riot. And a riot, normally what it does is it creates a kind of a situation in which emergency measures are taken. No emergency measure can be permanent. By definition, it cannot be permanent, right? So what we proposed in this model is actually replicable anywhere. There is absolutely no involvement of technology in this. If you, one of the things that we did was, if rivers are polluted or rivulets are polluted, we have proposed biotic ways of cleaning them up, tried and tested methods, which is part of the local wisdom. The species that are promoted are all almost always endemic species. They're not exotics. So there's a very high capacity to survive. So the money invested in planting certain types of trees and not only supports, not only is capable of survival, but if you look at the species that we have selected, it supports a very high biodiversity and potentially also gives nutrition to local communities. In fact, we are looking at this in connection with amendments to the Tree Act, so that people actually get the use of fruits. So there is a direct connection between the community in terms of how they protect those watersheds, how the watersheds clean up the contaminated areas. And the result is not just the use of fruits from the tree, but also the clean water, which will enter the groundwater systems and so on. And one of the other problems in Bangalore, a study was done about a decade ago. Most of the energy consumed in the city is for boiling water, because we have this habit of bathing in the morning, right? So the boilers are all turned on. So in the way electricity works, if everyone turns on the boilers, the amount of current consumed is very high. So we are wasting energy for boiling water. The next major consumption is for lifting water. The Kaveri water is given every 2 or 3 days. So everyone invests in a sump, and that water has to be lifted up, right? That's really a waste of energy, if you see it, right? So we have to find, and there are intelligent ways of getting around this problem. If you rainwater harvest, you can actually survive without any external input for 6 to 7 months, if you actually design it properly, design it intelligently. And half the city has been built in the last decade, right? And I don't see any reason why, when people are investing crores into facades, essentially, right? Why can't they be forced to? And that is where the state as a regulator has to intelligently step in. If an office complex is coming up which is 30 crores, 40 crores, I don't see any reason why the state should not insist that it has to be so designed that it does not invest in air conditioning systems, which is a energy and water guzzler, and that water is harvested, and at least recharge is done if you cannot store it. These are the methods where the state has to step in. And to make the state step in, I think community monitoring is the way forward. So that cannot work unless the tertiary level of our governance is made to be much more functional than it is today.
I just want to add one last
thing. I mean, you have said, not in your main presentation, but later on in one of the interventions, that you don't support the tertiary treatment systems. Now, whatever little is in the public domain, I've read that the IITs have issued guidelines recommending tertiary treatment systems for Ganga River Basin Authority, whatever is happening. So, and some of the documents of IIT is also saying that the sewerage treatment plants centralized are not relevant for India, and we want decentralized treatment systems, and some of the systems which are being talked about of the kind which you showed using biotic methods, etc. What I want to sort of ask you is that is there a kind of a policy legislative framework which says something about what kind of, whether there's a water policy or a wastewater policy in India, which says something definite, tangible on that, or are we leading it to the international donor agencies, consultants to push certain kind of things? Can you put a little guidance on that?
Sir, the point is very simple. Industries have no business dumping their waste into tank systems or river systems. There's no business. Because if you read the 74 Water Act, even before the 74 Water Act, take any municipal law. Industries had no business dumping untreated effluents into the water systems. Because they have been allowed to do that, tertiary treatment systems have a very high currency today. In fact, last year, I think the law says that industry should not dump effluents. If industries don't dump their effluents into our water systems, then what sewage has got into the is can be easily treated with biotic methods. It does not require tertiary treatment plant. By the natural flow of the river, quite a bit of the sludge can be removed. By constructed wetlands, you can do a lot more. Farmers grow fodder grass if it does not have toxic discharge. If it is just sewage, farmers will not prefer to grow paddies and sugar cane, but they will grow fodder grass, which will help in cattle rearing. And that's what they do in the entire Vrishabhavati Valley, which was actually a sugar cane and paddy valley, has turned into a fodder valley now. They can't go and cultivate there because of the toxic nature of the water. But they say, you know, it seems that the cattle don't die. If we were to go and stand there, our legs and, you know, hands get hurt. And
they are prepared to feed that to the cattle.
They are doing it. It's not they're prepared to. But the point is that they're, what else can they do? Their livelihood options are very limited.
Yeah.
The tertiary level. Is there a legislation or policy which says anything, whether that is the recommendation?
I think the law doesn't recommend the technology per se, but I think when you say highest level and all that, I have my doubts about it. Mm-hmm. Because last year the US trade mission came. They came because they said there is a $50 billion water industry. For them it is money. For them it is capital investment. For them it is capturing the investment here. They are not interested in giving you water. They are interested in capturing the business, and that's the way we would like to see it. In fact, we had a major battle in Bangalore on the streets, forced the government to come out. And the minister came out of, we said we are not coming to your Vidhan Sabha. You have fortified it. It's out of bounds for the people. You come out and you meet us. 5,000 people sat and just did not move for 2 days. And he came out and he said, we are boycotting that forum. So the US trade industry came, the US trade representative came, they just couldn't have a formal meeting. Next week in Bangalore on the 2nd, 3rd and 4th, there's a World Water Summit. Again, the same business. Everyone who's coming here is coming to sell their technology. And we have had a campaign for the last week going on in Bangalore. In fact, Bangalore has become a site for staging these companies. You know, and we get the technology. The tertiary treatment technology was first sold in Bangalore. Kabban Park is a living example of it. And that became a model suddenly. So there's a lot of, I mean, I wouldn't want to say just because Planning Commission says it, it's not right. We have to contest it. There is another argument we are making. Why do we need such technology?
Yeah, there are 3 points that I want to make. One is with respect to awareness. There is a huge gap between what groups like ours are doing and what is being written in school textbooks. I engage a lot with students of different age groups, college, high school, and even researchers. And I find that in many areas, we are still using very dated textbooks. I have students arguing with me that nuclear power plants is the best, or reverse osmosis is the best way to get clean water. That is one thing. The second thing is we have completely forgotten our traditional knowledge. I remember, you know, we all grew up with families where grandparents used silver and copper vessels, and now research has proved that copper and silver can remove a large amount of bacteria from water. And we do have a person in Bangalore in Indian Institute of Science who has recommended use of a silver ball in a pot of water to remove bacteria. And he even shows results of how from day one to day three, how the bacterial content in water has come down because just using a silver ball. So these are, you know, that traditional knowledge, not just in purification of water, even in farming systems, in using water from rivers, that is completely disregarded. And the third point that I wanted to make is with respect to policy. If you read many of these latest reports that are being released by UNCTAD and other agencies, there is a very strong drive to push for privatization, especially the PPP model, in practically everything. You take the seed industry, they are there. You take water industry, sewage industry, waste industry. We are fighting a huge battle in Bangalore again with respect to the waste problem because waste management has been privatized. Given that almost 90% of our waste is biodegradable, and we have this private agency called Ramki, which is making a mess of the waste, again contaminating all the tanks and rivers and even groundwater. So if all of us stand up and, you know, really fight, then what is being recommended by these big reports across, you know, there's something called the World Competitiveness Report, World Investment Report, hundreds of these reports, and the same language is in the Planning Commission report, the McKinsey report, which our bureaucracy is blindly implementing. There isn't a proper consultation with people. And something else is we have a problem in marking experts. We don't regard our farmers at all. We don't find farmers sitting on any boards, any consultations. It is experts sitting inside their labs who are making decisions for us. We really need to change that. Thank you.
Sum it up because we'll have to sum up at the end of this entire series. Each of these is really a learning experience. So we're trying to gather insights and ideas. So we've had a very two interesting presentations and a very rich discussion. Thank you very much, and I expect your written papers as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.